Good afternoon, everybody that's watching this interview. Today, I'm fortunate to be with the great Italian trumpet superstar, Andrea Lucchi, who is currently the principal trumpet in the Santa Cecilia Orchestra in Rome. And Andrea, it's a pleasure to meet you finally and to have you on to do an interview.
Yes, thank you. And it's nice to see you now. And I'm very happy to be your guest for this interview.
And for some people that don't know your background, you've been in St. Cecilia since 2003. And before then, you were La Scala also.
And yes.
We'll go over that in just a minute. So,
yes, it's a long walking from the beginning. Going back from Santa Cecilia, I was before Santa Cecilia in the Radio Television Symphony Orchestra in Turin, that is the National Radio Symphony Orchestra of Italy, RAI, and from 1996. And then before Radio Television of RAI was my first job as principal trumpet. And during these years, I was studying in Germany with Max Mahalder in Detmold. And before winning the competition in RAI, I was a substitute in Scala for 4 years, where I play also principal trumpet and tutti, when it was chief conductor Riccardo Muti. And before that, I was in a symphony orchestra of Emilia Romagna, that's the country in the middle of Italy, named Arturo Toscanini. That was my first experience in the orchestra. From the 1986 until about 1991, it was here in when I had to do my military service. You know, in Italy, you were obliged to go and be military for 1 year.
Oh.
Yeah, yes. With guns and...
All of
no
that.
Trumpet.
No trumpet.
No trumpet. No.
Well, let's back up a little further and talk about your studies with your father, who was your first teacher.
Yeah. When I was about 8 years old, we lived in Rimini, that is a very small city on the Adriatic Sea. And my father was a trumpet player, playing most of the time in the dancing orchestra. Mm-hmm. Was not classic music player. And, you know, when you are eight, you are listening to your father practicing every day and playing beautiful music, and he was putting every day recordings by Maurice André and Pierre Thibault. So my imprinting of the music for trumpet was like that. And I said, Daddy, I want to play the trumpet like you. And my father said, yes, you are very young to start, but we can try. And I started studying the trumpet, but you know, when you are eight, you don't want to study. You just want to have fun.
Yeah.
So between one football match and the other, sometimes I was practicing the trumpet. But my father was a good teacher because he had a great passion for the trumpet, for the music. And he realized many brass groups with his students and big band, marching band. So I had many opportunities to make practice, to make the music with the trumpet already when I was young in different situations. Very wow. Good. Yes.
What kind of things did he get you to play early on? Was it songs or?
Yes. It was not a teacher that push me to play technical stuff because, you know, in Italy, when I was young, it was not so many methods Just some books, you know, Gatti, Peretti. It's some books, methods, Italian, just Italian methods. And my father was one of the first trumpet teacher in Italy to bring the American school in his class, like Colin Schlossberg, and we didn't have already James Stamp, for example. But you know, he was not a classic trumpet player, so he could do many things, but just for his passion. And yes, yeah, most of the time he suggested to us to play songs, music. So that's why he wanted to bring us to play in a band, because he said always, you have to get pleasure from playing. You have to have fun, and you don't have to leave your studying of the trumpet as difficult stuff. You have not to feel to be obliged to do it and to do boring things. You have to have fun, enjoy your time with your instrument.
Yeah.
It was the approach.
When did you start to hear orchestras?
It's about my first experience was when I was in my last year of studies in the conservatory, because I was about 16. It was funny because in the conservatory of Pesaro, where I was studying in the last 2 years of my career of student, there was an orchestra named Filarmonica Marchigiana, as the country of Marche, and it was connected to the conservatory of Pesaro, where I was student. And they had to make a concert on TV, live on TV, with a New World Symphony by Dvorak, no? And it was funny because all the teachers that play usually in the orchestra doesn't want to play. They didn't want to play because it was live on TV, so they were afraid to don't be. And the conductor of the orchestra invited my teacher that was named Terzo Cattani, was a really amazing trumpet player. But he said, I don't want to go playing with these people. I will send you playing instead of me. But he was really young, and I never played anything in the orchestra.
Wow.
It was my first experience. I think I have a videotape recording of this concert.
Wow.
I was, yes, 15 or 16 years old. It was amazing concert, clear. I was not an expert player, but it was nice.
Did you start to listen to, or what orchestra did you start to listen to as a student?
Oh, many orchestras, because most of the time I started listening to the recordings that my father had at home. So he had a lot of recordings from Chicago Symphony, Boston Symphony, Philadelphia, New York, London Symphony also. And some things also Berliner Philharmoniker and Wiener. A lot of vinyl recording, you know, disc. So it was very nice, and yes, that was my listening in that period.
Talk a little bit about your teacher, Terzo Cattani. Tell me about him a little bit, and what things did you work on with him?
Yes, I went to the conservatory to study with Terzo Cattani when I got my half studies of trumpet. In Italy, the studies of trumpet was about 7 years to get the diploma. And after the fifth here, you got an examination, and after that I went to the conservatory. So I left my father. It was my father that said, Andrea, I think you have to change teacher because going on with your father would be absolutely for sure not the best solution because, you know, we are too friendly. And for me, he was really bad with me. Eh? Always worse than all the other students.
Of course.
But, you know, it was my father. So he said, you have to go to the conservatory. So I got my examination of the fifth year in the conservatory of Pesaro. And then I appointed for the class to continue the studies in the conservatory. And they met this teacher, Cattani Terza, that was my first teacher with a classic music experience. Mm-hmm. He came from the school of Parma that was one of the most famous school of trumpet in Italy. The teacher was Robuschi. Mm-hmm. His name is famous in Italy because all the trumpet, the most, the best trumpet players in Italy of the 17th were students from Robuschi, and Cattani Terzo was student of the class of Robuschi, and he was really interested to teach to you to play with many colors. Mm-hmm. For example, I started to studies on Arban, mm-hmm. the French method, Arban,
right.
The modern studies, Théo Chalier, mm-hmm. Solomon, and started to practice also Intrada, my first time with yeah. Honegger. Yes. Now it's completely changed because in the conservatory, the students start earlier to mm-hmm. practice on this kind of music. But for me, it was completely new. And it was not easy from the beginning. But in 2 years, this teacher changed completely my feeling to play mm-hmm. because instead of playing always the same things I was used to play in my school with my father, I got used to play Charlier, all the studies, really,
wow.
really with a good feeling, and the modern studies by Arban, always, you know the second study.
Yes.
Sometimes we could stay like 45 minutes in the first three lines.
Oh, very detailed.
I started playing. And he said, Andrea, this is not enough piano. Okay. Yes, but now you lose your sound. You lose your tone. Start again. Let's start again. Someone wants to come in.
Or he wanted to leave. The dog. The
probably,
dog
yeah,
about
yes.
to make some noise.
Yes, he is the lord of the house.
Yeah, absolutely. Even though it's very okay. small, it's still the lord of the house. did he work on orchestral excerpts with you as well?
Not so much. That's why when I finished the conservatory, and I started to make the first audition for orchestra jobs, I was always wonderful playing for Haydn, for Honegger, Brandt, mm-hmm. but every time I stopped for the solos, for the orchestra repertoire, because I was not used to practice it. And yep. I had to start because otherwise I could not win a competition.
Right.
And I think this step was by the other teacher, Max Omerhalder.
I was going to ask you about yeah. that in just a second, because I wanted to know a little more about the Italian conservatory. Did you have to study subjects that were not music at school, or was once you came in the conservatory, it was all music what you studied?
You mean can you explain sure.
in American schools
yes
there's music and you have some general studies of history or language, was it all music?
Oh, I think in the conservatory you have a repertory that you have to follow. Mm-hmm. You can, in Italy, you can have a choice mm-hmm. between some similar pieces, similar kind of music, but you have a line to follow. You can choose from, I don't know, three different modern pieces, but you know, now the conservatory in Italy is changed a lot mm-hmm. from when I was student. And in reason that I'm not teacher in the conservatory, I'm not teaching, I'm not sure that I'm telling the truth, but I meet a lot of students that come from the conservatory and come to do a postgraduate studies with me. And I know almost that they can choose between some pieces, but they have a repertory almost fixed to follow to get the final diploma. Mm-hmm. Depend on the level.
Right.
You have like a medium level, high level, and postgraduate level. But I think actually in the conservatory in Italy, depend on the teacher.
Mm. Okay.
Because if you have a good teacher that had a great experience for classic music in the orchestra or as a solist, you will have a good studying with a great repertory.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you can have also not so good teachers.
Yes.
Because, you know, I don't know. I know that in Germany, for example, if you want to teach in a school, you have to make a competition. You have to win a competition. And in Italy for many years it was not like this. I was teacher in the conservatory and I got my competition in 1991. And after that year, they never do it anymore. So now all the teachers that got a position in the conservatory as teacher, like, you know, you make substitution, mm-hmm. and then finally you get your job. I think this is not a good solution for the quality, you know, because sometimes all the people that is not able to win a competition in the orchestra or something else is going to be a teacher in the conservatory.
I see.
So you have to choose if you have to do high level studies for the conservatory in Italy. Mm-hmm. You have to know who is the teacher and where, and have a good choice. Otherwise, you will spend 2 years making nothing.
I understand.
If you're lucky. If you're unlucky, you can get worse.
Well, talk a little bit about your studies with Max Sommerhalter.
Yes, Max was like a big light in my life because I was studying after the conservatory that was finished when I was 17. Mm-hmm. I studied by myself on the recordings mm-hmm. That I had at home and CBS Masterworks by Wynton Marsalis.
Yes.
That I love absolutely. And Maurice André was my two kind of music and was about 10 years studying by myself.
Wow.
It's a long walking by myself and was not easy, but you know, when I started at 19 to play in this Arturo Toscanini Symphony Orchestra was easiest because I had the job in the orchestra, I met many other trumpet players, so we could practice together and make brass groups, so it was really, really nice and was good for my growing up. Mm-hmm. It was not bad. And I, in that years, I won a lot of competition also with prize for solist and in other orchestra, I won auditions. But when I was about, you know, 26, 27, I said, there's something that I miss too much, because I don't know why everybody tell me that I'm a good trumpet player, amazing trumpet player, beautiful sound, but I cannot win a competition for principal trumpet. My biggest dream was to get a position as a principal trumpet in a symphony orchestra.
Right.
So one day when I was playing in radio television orchestra of Switzerland in Lugano, I met the wife of Max Sommerhalder, because she was playing violin in the orchestra. And when I knew that she was his wife, I asked her to arrange a meeting with him for me to have a private lesson. Mm-hmm. And the first time I went at home, at Max's home in Switzerland on the mountain. Mm-hmm. And it was like to put my feet in a paradise.
Yeah.
You know, when you come in a new dimension and you see people that lives really simply, but completely in love and with a perfect connection with the music. They were talking every day about music, listening every time classical music. And I came from a country for disco. Boots, 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 boots. You know? Rimini is famous for holidays. It's like Miami. Miami, yes. Beach, Los Angeles is music, people, the beach, the sea, and everything. And it was really, really nice, because Max gave me a lesson not about the techniques of the trumpet principle. Mm-hmm. Was about the music. And I remember that we were practicing on the D concert, D major concert by Telemann, that I should have to play in Milan 1 week later. And I said, Maestro, I am not sure that if it's good piece for me, because I don't know if I can play, because it's a very hard piece for me. I don't think to how it's hard for you the piece. That just breathe and blow beautiful music in the instruments. This was the first step. It was the first step, and was like, you know, to open my mind to a new idea.
Yeah.
And so I was like shocked from this first lesson. It was about 3 hours and a half. But I was not tired. I was absolutely not tired. I was really happy. And I said, can you take me with your students? Because mm-hmm. I would like to follow you. Ah, yes, Andrea, you can come here when you want. No. I want to come to Germany where you teach in the school. And I want to get, you know, postgraduate studies with you, because I think I want to study. And I was already 27 years old.
Yes,
I was major, not probably a little bit late for studying, but I was really happy to have met this beautiful person that gave to me like a new perspective,
a new perspective.
Perspective of the life for a trumpet player. And so we started study together, and I follow him in Germany. Mm-hmm. And we passed about 3 years together. But you know, after 7-8 months studying with him, mm-hmm. I won my competition in radio television orchestra in Turin. And in 7 months, I was completely changed, completely. You know, Max told me, Andrea, if you want to be principal trumpet in a symphony orchestra, you need to have heaviest sound. Mm-hmm. Your sound is beautiful, it's singing sound, it's beautiful music, but it's too clear, it's too light. You need the most powerful sound, and when you play loud, you don't have to lose your body of your mm-hmm. sound. You don't have to scream.
Yeah.
No, you have to sing loud, and it was the meaning of I think the most important thing that he gave to me. Also clear, I started at least to practice the orchestra repertory. And yeah. Max was amazing also for this, because teach me to play all the orchestra stuff, I think, in the best way, because anytime after that school, I went to the orchestra or competition or playing in the orchestra, and I had to play a new piece that I studied with Max, I was completely in the perfect way. I was playing completely in the perfect, and no one conductor says me anywhere, because it was, yes, and I played with Giuseppe Sinopoli, many times with Lorin Mazella, Zubin Mehta, you know, all the biggest conductor. And somehow that gave me this quality,
right,
to be a right principal trumpet for a symphony orchestra.
What things did he do to help you change your sound? How did you make your sound bigger?
Yes, different things. Starting from the instrument, obviously, because the instrument and the mouthpiece. Mm-hmm. Because from the beginning of my career of trumpet player, my father understood immediately that it was not such a powerful lips. Mm-hmm. I had not such powerful lips for trumpet playing, and he always found for me solution to have a light instrument and the easy mouthpiece to play, because you know, I got my first year in conservatory that it was difficult for me to play IC. Yeah. You know, when I went to my first audition in the orchestra, I had to play Intrada. Mm-hmm. This is a funny history, because it was my first audition in Milan in the Pomeriggi Musicale Symphony Orchestra, and when I was preparing by myself this audition, I realized that I couldn't play Intrada, because when I was in the conservatory, yes, we tried to play, but I always missed a little power for the high tones. And my father, that plays in a big band and dancing music orchestra, he said, I will give you a special mouthpiece for high tones. you know, jet tone?
Yes. Uh-huh.
Yes.
Yeah,
can you imagine to play Intrada on the jet tone mouthpiece? So you can just play a good IC, but without any other tone. Yes, yeah. Exactly. But the problem, unfortunately, Intrada starts from a low A.
Yes.
So my performance started like this. And I have to tell you honestly, also the IC didn't come. It was completely... But coming back to some Halder school, so I had my tools were tools for a trumpet player that was not so powerful. And Max said to me, Andrea, you absolutely have powerful, but you don't know how to use it. Mm-hmm. That was amazing discovery for me, because Andrea, you are not able to breathe correctly. So he teaches me to breathe correctly, and especially to blow into the trumpet. Mm-hmm. Because he saw that I was practicing with a lot of buzzing on my lips and on the mouthpiece. And he said, Andrea, I don't know how you can do all the time this, because for me it's dangerous. And I discovered that it was dangerous also for me when some years later I got a dystony for playing too much without trumpet. Oh. That this is another chapter of my life, bad chapter. But just for finish this discussing about
Max,
what we changed it. So Max suggested me to change the mouthpiece, and we moved to, I used a 17 Schilke for all my life. Mm-hmm. until 27 years old. And then I moved to Brazil, you know, the screw system mouthpieces, G2 almost, and the trumpet, yes, I had with the star, back with the star, you know, the light model, and right. We moved to a standard model. Mm-hmm. But I didn't feel the difference, because when we changed the instrument, Max suggested me to play, you know, breathing. I was playing mostly on the lips. So, you know, buzzing on the lips. So that's why I was not so powerful. And he teach me to use the air, blowing different. And nothing. When I got my position in radio television in Turin, mm-hmm. and the final round, almost all the other candidates were killed before the finish. And it was the only one staying on the stage and continue playing, because I was never tired.
Yeah.
Never.
Yeah.
Wow. And there was, I could play really powerful high tones and low tones and everything. It was really, really the most important stone of my life, I think, this year with Max.
Can you talk, and while we're talking about auditions, can you tell mm-hmm. me what is the system in Italy? Is there the first round, is yeah. it behind a screen, or is it, uh-huh. Can everybody
depend.
See?
Yes, it's not always the same. Depend on, I will see if it can go, can have more lights now. And normally for auditions, for substitution in the orchestra, we don't have a curtain, we don't have anything. You play in front of the jury because, you know, it's not so important. And for the first round, for example, I saw that different from other countries, we play mostly concert, mm-hmm. like Haydn or Intrada or Brandt, depend on the orchestra, on the principal trumpets, what they want to listen to. But normally we play like a piece of concert, one movement or two movements, and then immediately some solos, for example. Mm-hmm. Like Mahler 5, Zarathustra, G concert, Ravel. And then in the second round, if it's just an audition for substitution, mm-hmm. You make other solos, more solos.
From the
this
orchestra.
Is for, yes, this is for auditions. When you make like for band stage of the theater. But when you make a competition, for a position in the orchestra, mm-hmm. It's a little bit different, mm-hmm. because, for example, oftenly now you have a curtain in front of you that, you know,
yes,
and you play, but yes, different from other country, we play oftenly starting with a concert. Mm-hmm. And I know that many orchestras, also in the United States, they ask first like solos, mm-hmm. and then if it goes to the second round, for example, we play also a piece of concert. But in Italy, normally you start with a concert and then some solos. Then second round, probably another piece of concert, like Tomasi, you grow up of level,
yeah.
and other solos. And then, for example, in my orchestra, the final round is in the orchestra with the orchestra.
Okay.
That's amazing, because you have to play many pieces and with the orchestra and inside of the orchestra. So all colleagues can enjoy your playing and play with you, and you can really... feel the sensation to be a part of the orchestra. That's the best solution.
Yes. And when you say you're playing with the orchestra, is it many just trumpet passages, or does that mean you're playing a week of concerts?
No. The final round, you have a list of almost 10 pieces to 12 pieces, mm-hmm. and it's like extracts, Yes. Excerpts. But not just the solo. For example, if you play Mahler 5, you play the beginning, mm-hmm. and then you play from Plötzlich. Mm-hmm. And this is a long piece, a long part.
Yes.
Because you have to play until and until this moment you have to play everything with the orchestra exactly in the concert.
Wow.
No, that's amazing. That's yeah. amazing.
Is that normal for most orchestras?
In Italy?
In Italy. Yes.
It's not everywhere. Not everywhere. I think in Italy, Santa Cecilia, I think is, if not the only one of the really few orchestras that use this system, because I think other places doesn't do the same. They make the final round alone on yes. the stage. As my competition, when I won the competition in Turin, was like that.
In Italy, also on an audition, are you still playing pistons and rotary, or just piston?
Yeah, now is starting to be also like this. You have to be able to play everything. For example, when I won the competition in Turin, mm-hmm. in the 1996, I played all the stuff of Bruckner and Wagner on the rotary valves, because I was studying in German. I got my first Monke B flat instrument, and Max told me somehow there, you have to play this music on the rotary valves. But it was absolutely not obliged. It was my choice, and I was the only one playing on the rotary valve. When I won the competition in Rome, for example, it was also not necessary to use the rotary valves. But now, in these last years, most of the orchestra in Italy ask also to play like Second Symphony of Schumann, Second mm-hmm. Symphony by Brahms on the rotary valves. Yes. And, as they ask to play piccolo and pisto cornet.
Do you still play Monke rotaries?
I sold out many years ago to change my motorcycle, you know. It was funny, I know. But, you know, it was after 1 year that I was principal trumpet in Turin, I finished my studies in Germany, and the B-flat rotary valves was, you know, I didn't need it because in the orchestra I never played B flat.
Right.
When I use B flat, it's just for playing. If I play Italian opera mm-hmm. or Gershwin or Bernstein music, I play the B flat. Otherwise, just on the C trumpet, and the rotary valves in B flat was, you know, not needed.
Yeah.
So in that moment, I was changing my motorcycle. And I need money, so I sold out my Monke and bought a new motorcycle.
Good plan. What rotary do you play now?
Rotary valves, that is a Dovitz trumpet, Dovitz. Mm-hmm. And we bought it in Munich when I went to his office and choosing lead pipes, bells, and the machine and everything. And I got a really nice instrument, very nice instrument.
And do you use different mouthpieces for the rotary and the piston?
Yeah, you know, rotary valves needs a different mouthpiece that what we are used to play on the piston trumpet. But from when I use a lot of time rotary valves on the orchestra, I got used to play also the piston trumpet with the rotary valves mouthpiece, because it gives me a brilliant but rich tone that is every day most asked from the conductors. It's, you know, the sound of my orchestra is changed in these last years, and it's always dark and rich and yes. great, and And if you have too clear sound, is not so good. So I use a Yamaha 15-4 mouthpiece for the rotary valves, and sometimes I put a different rim because for me it's not always comfortable. Sometimes on the piston trumpet is not good because you have all the tones after center. But for orchestra music is not difficult for me. But otherwise, I switch between Bresenmeier and Yamaha 15-4. But yes, if I have to play a Mahler 5, I can play on the 15-4 also on the piston trumpet. If you have to play like Pine of Roms, for example, a Respighi or Feste Romane, is a little bit too hard. And so Bresenmeier is best.
Ah, okay. Okay.
Yeah.
And speaking of different instruments, can you talk a little bit about your practice at home and how do you start your day? What things do you do to get the pace?
Yes. Normally, I like to start playing immediately on the trumpet, for example, because as I told you before, I got a dystony in my life, and it was the worst things I can imagine for a trumpet player. Mm-hmm. When you lose completely your lips and you don't know what's happened when you go to play.
Yes.
You blow into the trumpet and nothing comes. Or otherwise, that's why, because I was practicing high tones on the rim, just on the rim, you know.
Oh.
And I felt like a pain on my lips. And from that moment, it looks like my lips lose completely the memory mm-hmm. of what they were used to do before. And so I try to refix, to solve the problem mm-hmm. and making what I was used to do every day. Buzzing, putting the mouthpiece. But you know, nothing comes, and on the mouthpiece, worst. On the trumpet was like 3 years of, it was like to be hell. Absolutely, absolutely bad, because I couldn't not leave my orchestra.
Right.
And sometimes I went on the stage really afraid, shaking, because I already knew that I was not able to play everything at my level. So, from the beginning of my studies by myself after the conservatory until that moment, I was used to make buzzing, to practice on the mouthpiece, and then on the trumpet, long tones, lip flexibilities, and pedal tones, James stamps, you know, I think all the stuff that every trumpet player play every day.
Yeah.
After that, I try to fix the problem, making the same thing, but doesn't work. Mm-hmm. And so when I met Andy Crowley, you know, the trumpet player from London Brass, mm-hmm. I met him and I saw him playing so beautiful sound and beautiful music. And he said, Andrea, why don't you try to practice just on your trumpet? I think you have to start to do something different. Mm-hmm. Because otherwise you will get crazy and you will not playing anymore your trumpet. So from that moment, I started practicing just playing, like making vocalizes, like the singer.
Yes.
with slurred or articulation. And then starting from the easiest melody I can play, I think it's like the idea of Chikovitz, you know?
Yes.
Yeah, you start playing easy tones, and then from that point, you going growing up little by little, doing something more difficult mm-hmm. and making different things. That's what I'm doing every day when I go. For example, when I have to go to the orchestra, mm-hmm. sometimes I don't practice. I don't have a warm up like more than 5 minutes. I take my trumpet that I have to play on the stage, like hopefully the C trumpet, piston trumpet, and I play a few tones, and they go, I warm up playing in the orchestra.
Yeah.
Then if I have free time after the rehearsal, I go in my practicing room, down the stage, and I play some stamp or Chikovitz or what I like to play. I discovered that playing too much technics stuff before playing is not so good for me, because it gives me like if you need to do it every day.
Yes.
And I don't love it. When I have to play Mahler 5, I start praying, my morning start like, and then I try to find the best way to play C sharp triplets in the easiest way I can.
Yes.
That's my idea to play, and what I'm teaching to all my students, and I'm finding that it works a lot. Then clear, if you have all day long for free, and like these days that I don't play in the orchestra, I also start playing with vocalize or easy tones, but I practice like concert. I have a project for the next year. I will record some trumpet sonata for trumpet and piano, like Jean Francais, Hindemith, Honegger, and Enescu, and Tomasi Tritic. So I'm already practicing for this, and I spend my time doing something for growing up my technical stuff and my fingers, my lips, my eye tones, my colors. That's, I don't have a routine.
A routine. Yeah. Yes. Do you practice on C trumpet most of the time, or mix?
I love B flat.
Yes.
like each Italian trumpet player, I think we born with B flat on our hands. So
yes.
I think B flat for me is more comfortable. But honestly, when I play in the orchestra, I practice on the C trumpet. Yes. Or if I have to, like this morning, I wanted to play Tomasi Triptych and Jean Francais Sonatina, I warm up with my C trumpet, and then after 10 minutes, I go to play, like, I go slower, and I'm not ready to play perfectly all the stuff, but I prefer if I have to play pa 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 pi pa 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 pi pa 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 pi pa pa, I don't need to practice 2 hours of lip flexibilities, and then I need tonguing. So
yes.
When I made some vocalize just to open my throat and just to warm up my lips and my blowing, I prefer to study what I need
right
at that moment.
Right. And speaking of B flat trumpet, I've noticed sometimes in the concerts with Santa Cecilia, you play C trumpet, and some of your colleagues play B flat.
Oh, yes. Yes, could happen. Yeah.
Is that a tradition in Italy, or is that unique, or is that just personal?
No, it's I think my idea, my opinion is that everyone has to play the instrument who gave him the best sensation, the best feeling.
Mm-hmm.
So when my colleagues ask to me, Andrea, doesn't matter if I play the B flat or the C trumpet. For example, when I played sometimes Gershwin or Bernstein West Side Story, I play on the B flat, and my colleagues played on the C trumpet.
Yes,
the tutti played on the C trumpet. It's you know, I think you have to use the instruments that gives to you the best sound and the best feeling, so you can play the most beautiful music. I never oblige my colleague to use the same instrument I play.
Yes,
never.
Right.
Sometimes happen that when we play Mahler Second Symphony, Mahler Third Symphony, as you know, some parts have very low tones.
Yes.
Like the E natural low, E, and
right.
So if you have, and you also have this tone as principal trumpet, but you cannot play it because you have tutti playing on the B flat.
Wow. Yeah, right. Exactly. Exactly.
Yeah. So it's not, doesn't matter for me. And sometimes also playing the low parts on the B flat, sometimes you get the most beautiful sound.
I just thought I wanted to go back to something you talked about. You talked about when you had the lip injury.
Yeah.
It changed your practice. How did you keep your mind clear?
Oh. I think I cannot tell you everything I thought in that years, but because it was very bad, bad, because my feeling was that my life was finished, you know, but in the same time, I got married and I was waiting for my first son. Mm-hmm. So I could not live my life.
Yes.
It was, and I thought when I was looking at my boy, my small boy,
yeah,
coming to the light, I said, I don't want that my son as a father, a loser. I have to give a good example of living in a life. So it was like a new energy for me to fight against it. This is a monster.
Yes.
Because as you know, also, I think also Phil Smith got similar problem, and he is still talking about this, because it's strange when you are principal trumpet in a so great orchestra and one day you have to stop because you cannot control what you play.
Yeah.
So in that moment was really strange for me, because it was some days that seems that something was coming back good, and yes, today I have a good sensation. And for 3 days later was completely bad. And I don't know, just probably a sensation of don't leave any chance, don't leave any opportunity to save myself.
Yes.
This is my character. I will fight until I have life. So this is my feeling. And when I was in that moment, it was really difficult, because, and my wife, I think, will remember very, very well, because I was nervous every day. I was black every day. It was difficult to smile, to enjoy my life, all the things I had in that moment, because my thinking was just on the trumpet. And but I never lost to looking for something new to happen. So when I told you I met Andy Crowley, and I don't know why I didn't think about it before, because it was almost natural.
Yeah.
So the only one chance you have, if you cannot go back to your shape, natural shape, doing the same thing you are used to do every day, you have to change. You have to change idea. So once I started to practice in a different way, day by day, I felt that something was coming back to me.
Right.
And was the period of the first tournée with Antonio Pappano, our chief conductor in Europe, where we played Mahler's First Symphony and Pini di Roma, Feste Romane, and then many other things. And from that moment, I started again to have fun playing. But you know what was really strange? It was that any time I had to play a piece that I played before, in the 3 years of my problem, I was completely afraid.
Wow. Yeah, sure.
You know, for example, it happens that I played Bruckner's Seventh Symphony. Mm-hmm. And when comes pa 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 pa, pa no? Mm-hmm. I had to ask to my second trumpet to play one tone for me because I could not jump in one octave by myself.
Yeah. Wow.
Can you imagine? And or yes, pictures. You know, when I played pictures with the Distony, was not difficult to play pa pa pa. The promenade was perfect because I could play loud. Mm-hmm. And the piccolo, Samuel Goldenberg, was perfect. But you know where's the worst moment? Yes, the catacombs. Yes. And when I started to play this, and I could not fix my tone. I could not keep my tone fixed. I was losing. And also that concert, after all the rehearsal, playing bad, I asked to my second trumpet, Hermano, I said, please play for me this solo. And he said, no problem, Andrea, sing to your son and don't be afraid. Don't worry and go. And you know, when comes after this long period, when comes pictures, I was afraid that something could happen again. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's like a nightmare, like yes. A nightmare.
Yes.
But no, after that was everything perfect. But you know, probably I didn't get back my lips because I still have a sensation to don't have the same shape when I play.
Yeah.
So I just change completely my way to think when I play.
Yeah.
You know, before my playing was buzzing, produce my sound.
Yeah.
And all the control was inside my mouthpiece, inside the rim. And now my playing is blowing, mm-hmm. blowing makes vibrate my lips.
Yes.
So it's a different meaning and different idea. And so I can still have fun and enjoy my playing the trumpet.
Do you remember a moment after all of this when you said, I'm back here?
Oh,
now.
It's not a precise moment, you know, because it was gradually day by day. But no, I don't remember a day because every day, also when I was getting back to a good shape, I had something wrong in the concert. So something that was, you know, sometimes also play, if you play Beethoven violin concert, mm-hmm. and in the beginning you play la, 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 you know?
Yeah.
Yes. So you play a Seventh Symphony of Beethoven in the same evening. That was great. Ah, yeah, beautiful. I'm back. But you play violin concert and you cannot control playing piano tones. So it was really day by day, year by year. It was not one day that I was feeling that everything was, yes, now I'm back to my, probably still today, I'm not feeling that I'm back. I will not be back to my good shape of when I was young, because as I told you, I had to change completely the way to play.
Yeah.
But I discovered new things,
yes.
new
yes.
options that gave me the opportunity also for being a good teacher.
Yes. Yes.
And here we open really another big discussion about teaching, because you know, in Italy comes a lot of foreigner schools, mm-hmm. and a lot of people make big confusion about playing on the mouthpiece, playing and practicing. And when you give master classes in the conservatory, as I had last one in the last weekend, mm-hmm. And you see a lot of people completely blocked because someone teach them to start playing on the mouthpiece. You know, okay, but the mouthpiece is difficult. The mouthpiece is not an instrument. And I suggest also to practice on the mouthpiece, but once you are warm up, when you are okay, when you already are in a good shape, you can get better your center of tone. You can grow up your level of control practicing on the mouthpiece, but you cannot starting practicing on the mouthpiece with young students.
Yes.
So they explain to them to start making music on the mouthpiece, and it's very hard for the lips because you try to make vibrating the lips in a situation that is absolutely not natural.
Yeah.
And so you meet a lot of people completely blocked. They breathe and they... you cannot imagine how many people blocked when start playing. That's another big problem. I got it also.
Yes.
But it's natural. If you are waiting for your lips that has to play instead of your blowing, that's natural. If you have to play Mahler 5 and you are waiting for your lips to play instead of you, that like this, and you breathe and you're blocked, you're breathing, you're blowing, that's not possible. So it's much better if you open your mouth and learn to do like... That's absolutely easy.
Yeah.
But not easy to explain.
No, I understand. I mean, did you ever practice to get out of that without the tongue, just starting notes without the tongue and
just without the tongue?
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. When I find some people blocked behind the tonguing, this is the first suggestion. Yes. Please go blowing into the trumpet fast, looking for a tone without tonguing.
Yes.
This is the first solution to open the throat.
absolutely. Yes. Yeah. And I would also imagine, I mean, I had some problems, an injury for a few years I can tell you about later, but this nightmare, you're right. Exactly. I think that if people have never had a problem like that or this, you can't imagine until it happens to you.
No. You cannot imagine. Absolutely.
But I don't know if you find this, but I find I enjoy playing so much more.
Yes.
Because of that, you know? So it's, it doesn't feel like, even though there was a nightmare,
yes,
the other side is so much better.
Absolutely. 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 Yeah. No, that's also my sensation.
Yeah.
I enjoy much more my playing than before. Because before was most of my work was technical, was buzzing, mouthpiece, and making exercises. Now what I'm looking for, and it's easy to understand listening my recordings. I'm always looking for special colors of the tones, phrasing, color, different tonguing expressions, and that's the music.
Yes.
And if you have a good conductor, can help you a lot for this, because when he asked you to make different, in Italian we say pronunciation.
Yes.
Pronunciation.
Yes.
I don't want to play when you play a soft melody like. Ta 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 ri ta. It's too strong.
Yeah.
So you have to learn also to play like ta da di da. It's, you know, it's a lot of things you can find if you are looking for music.
Yes.
And after the problem we had both. Now I know that you also got this problem. Playing the trumpet is really much more beautiful than before.
Yes. And by what you were just describing, the music first, you don't have the technical thoughts.
Yes.
Yeah. You know.
Yeah. Absolutely. Absolutely important.
Well, speaking of conductors.
Yes. Yeah.
Well, when you were coming out of this, you had your music director, Papano, right?
Yes. Yeah. Uh-huh.
He had to have noticed that it was getting better. Was he? Did he notice? Did he?
Yeah.
Did he? It was. Talk about him for a little bit. How is he with the orchestra? What are rehearsals like?
Yeah. Yes. No. Maestro Papano for me is a great musician. He's a great musician because he has always the feeling that when he is on the stage with the orchestra, he has to be a friend of everybody. And he wants to have a contact, direct contact with any one of us, and wants to make the music that he gets in his brain or in his soul. Mm-hmm. It's not so easy. Sometimes Papano said a really interesting thing. Guys, I'm so sorry for asking so many things to you, but you know, when I conduct you, I would like you to sound like my piano when my hands are over it. So it's not easy because I can manage my piano with my hands, with my ideas, with my feeling. And I would like to have a feedback from you as the fingers on my piano.
Yes.
So it's amazing because, and when I saw this piece from Mahler 9 Symphony that you put on Facebook, and looking him like conducting like this, and I remember exactly this moment and also during the rehearsal, he was asking many things, and was never enough. And that's why the level of this orchestra grew up a lot. Yeah. When he came, it was absolutely already a great orchestra. Santa Cecilia is a long tradition. Mm-hmm. They had Leonard Bernstein also as principal conductor. And they had many glorious moments as orchestra. But when I won the competition, I think it was not one of these best moments of the orchestra. Mm-hmm. And when Papano came, what was said for me was in the middle of my problem.
Yeah.
But yes, was the last year. But anyway, Papano was, I think for him, conducting was quite a new experience. Mm-hmm. So, you know, was not like clear like Lorin Maazel or Zubin Mehta.
Yes.
You know, also Georges Prêtre was not precise. No, Georges Prêtre, l'amour, la musique, also Valery Gergiev conducting like this. Huh?
Yeah, with the toothpick.
When I played Verdi Requiem with Gergiev, mm-hmm. The starting of the tuba mirum was, you know, was amazing. But anyway, it's important that the conductor gives you a musical feeling,
yes,
not the tempo. And Papano for this is amazing because, you know, for example, if you sometimes Papano was watching me when I was playing, and I was nervous, mm-hmm. because, you know, I was coming from my bad experience and it was not every week the same.
Yeah.
And sometimes after the rehearsal, he called me, Andrea, I have to tell you something. And I was afraid because I was afraid that he was not happy for me. But no, Papano said to me, Andrea, you know, sometimes I watch you, I see you playing, and it's like you are, if you are singing on the trumpet, and you are happy, and you put your bell up and you are happy. Sometimes, like this week, you are too worried about the mistakes. Please, don't worry about the mistakes and have fun, because your best music is when you have fun. Because I want to see you happy on the stage. I want to see you singing, as I see you some other times. Don't want to see you worry, because I'm your friend. Don't worry, because if you make mistakes, I make mistakes also.
Wow.
You know, it's nice, huh? And also, you know, when we played this, for example, last Mahler 9, mm-hmm. you know, when comes your solo. I made beautiful 4 lines of music. And when I finished, Papano stops, and all the orchestra was beating the feet. I don't know if United yeah, States has ever clapped. Bravo, bravo, Andrea, bravo. And Papano was talking to me, Andrea, beautiful, amazing. It's terrific. But you know, your first phrase is piano, but the second is pianissimo. Can you give me something different, please? And you, what can you do? You know, and I was happy because I made my best pianissimo.
Yeah.
Both the times. So the question is, playing louder the first time or more piano the second? Because you will get more risk if you try to play. And the result was this. I didn't want to play louder the first phrase. So I was fighting with the nature of my trumpet, but always looking for something best. So just for going to the end of this idea, if your conductor is a great musician, can give you a lot, absolutely a lot of chance to be also you, great musician, and make beautiful music with all the symphonies you play. And sometimes, for example, when it was like starting with the French horn, and they were playing like a little bit too late. Mm-hmm. You know what he said? Papano said, guys, why don't you breathe with me and go immediately to the sound? I saw you breathing before, and then you wait. That's not natural. You have to be like a singer. After breathing, singing. Oh, this is not natural that the conductor says to you such
nice
things.
Yes.
Yes, it's such suggestion, good suggestion for technical good playing for you.
Yes.
Normally is your teacher.
Yeah.
If he's a good teacher, not a conductor. Conductor can say to you, you are late, go with my, you know, my hands, you are late. No. He gives also musical suggestion to fix your technical problems. If you have an open mind, you can learn a lot from a good conductor. And so I think if we are a very good orchestra, for my opinion,
for
that
sure.
can make, so like we played last fifth of Bruckner with Blomstedt. Mm-hmm. It was the best Bruckner of my life. But I think that if the orchestra is able to do this kind of sound, this color of sound, is like 18 years with this conductor that also push us every time to do something more, something more, something more. It was never happy. You can give me something more. It was.
Wow.
Yes. Yes.
Wow.
Not easy, but very good for the result.
Yeah. Yeah. He sounds very encouraging.
Yes. Yes.
Not many conductors like that.
No. Because sometimes you can have easiest conductor.
Yeah.
Because they show to you everything where to put your tones, and so you feel safe.
Yeah.
But sometimes safe and music doesn't go together in the good way. In a good way. Safe is one thing, good music is different.
That's very true. That's very true.
Yeah.
Are there any other conductors you would like to, you have any stories about? You said Mazel.
Yes, Mazel. Mazel, it was amazing because Mazel, I met him also in other orchestras. When we played one concert, for example, it was a live TV concert for the government, the Italian government. Was a ceremony, and when we met him for the rehearsal in the same morning of the concert, we had a meeting at 8 o'clock in the morning with him. Yes.
Wow.
And the concert was like 12:30. Okay. So we had just 4 hours. And he wanted to play all the program three times. So after the second times playing all the program of the concert from the beginning to the end, me and the principal trombone player, Andrea Conti, probably you know, is famous. He studied yes. with Arnold Jacobs. And we went to Mazel because we knew him very good and said, Maestro, as you know, we have a concert live on TV in 1 hour and a half. So do you think it's absolutely necessary to play another time, one more time, all the program? And he said, why not? And we said, because I think we will get tired for the concert. You get tired. I've never seen you tired before. And otherwise, I don't know how to translate in English, but the meaning was, if you are not able to do this concert, why you are here? You know,
yeah.
You are here because you are a good musician, good trumpet player. So if you was not sure to be able to play this concert, we could ask someone else.
Oh.
No, that was the answer of Lorin Mazel. And he loves us because he knew us from a long time in different orchestras, Santa Cecilia, in Rai, in Florence. But it was like that. Unbelievable. And always like that with him. And...
What was the program?
Oh, a lot of Verdi symphonies. It was Forza del Destino, Ballabili dell'Otello, Don Carlo, Macbeth. It's a lot of symphonies from the opera
yeah.
of Verdi and Puccini. And then also Gershwin, Porgy and Bess, the suite. No, was was really hard. I have a video, live video recording. You can see on my YouTube page some of
that.
These pieces.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes. It's absolutely strong. It's a powerful concert, and we played louder than usual, just to fighting with against Mazel. You know, we played louder than normal. That was funny.
What about Riccardo Muti? I think you've played under him a few times too, right? Muti.
Recording Muti.
Muti.
Oh yes, Muti. Muti was. I met him when I was playing in Scala. And Muti is another absolutely great conductor. It's different from Papano. He has a really good conducting school for it. He's very clear when you have to follow him. And I made my first greatest experience in playing in the orchestra with him, because, you know, I was substitute in Scala for 4 years. I didn't have a position, a fixed position, but the principal trumpet of that time, that was Giuseppe Bodanza, for me, absolutely the best opera player for the trumpet. And I was lucky because I could stay close to him playing like second trumpet and big operas like Wagner, Walküre, and Rigoletto, you know, the most important operas of the Italian repertory, and also many, many symphony concerts, because, you know, Scala is also a philharmonic orchestra.
Right.
And they make a lot of tours. So sometimes when I got my position in Turin, they call me again to go and play principal trumpet in the tournée. And playing with Muti was always a party.
Yeah.
Because, yes, because he gave to the music, to the orchestra, also a sensation to be the most beautiful thing of the world.
Yeah.
Because he was like a lord, god of the music, you know. Yeah. Muti, when he's on the stage, Muti is god. Yeah. And you also, and he bring you, push you to be a part of this even. And playing with Muti is like to be a part of even. It's absolutely wonderful. And he gives to you a sensation to have, to live inside of the music.
Yeah.
And nothing. It's great. Great person, great conductor, absolutely.
Well, I want to ask you one more question before we wrap up, because, by the way, your English has been amazing.
No,
thanks. It's been very great.
We need to have an interview each day so I can refresh my English, but I am so sorry.
Oh, it's no, your English is very good. And
It's English.
No, and I know your taste in wine is better than mine, for sure.
This is a Chianti, but we talk so a lot, and I couldn't drink it, but I will drink. I will save for later.
Okay. So I know you have a lot of projects outside of the orchestra too.
Yes.
And I just saw the Fabrizio Basso video.
Yeah, great.
Could you talk about that a little bit?
Yes, with great pleasure, because Fabrizio is, you know, as I told you about. Max Omhalder was like a big light for me. Mm-hmm. Fabrizio is not a big light because he's a great inspiration for being musician in complete way.
Yeah.
Just not thinking about the attacks, the tones. And Fabrizio is an amazing musician. You cannot imagine how is when you have on your right side such a great player that can makes the smooth attacks much better than you could play in that you play in the orchestra, and this is your job every day. When you have a feeling that close to you you have such a big musician and the big man and the great man, Fabrizio is unbelievable. He has the power to play everything on the trumpet.
Yeah.
Some years ago, we got a project together to play jazz, baroque music, jazz music, movie soundtrack music together with the string orchestra and the jazz piano player. Mm-hmm. And it was amazing because we made concert on the squares. And for example, we started together playing a piece by Seminestico. I don't know if a portrait of a trumpet.
Yes.
And yes, it's an arrangement for trumpet and strings and piano. And, you know, we play switching, we play, you know, one line for each, and was amazing to listen the different way to play the same music. And for people was amazing, because after that, for example, I came in on the piccolo and I played the concerto sonata by Telemann, all the concert and baroque music with harpsichord also. And then after that, Fabrizio came in with the jazz piano player and play like in a sentimental mood, the standard ballads. And then I came back also, and then together we played an arrangement of movie soundtrack by Morricone and Ennio Rota, and Nino Rota and Ennio Morricone.
Yeah, yeah.
La Strada, Il Padrino, you know, and then the most famous movie soundtrack from our amazing composers. And it was unbelievable playing, because the same phrase, like you know, Nuovo Cinema Paradiso.
Yes.
Listen to him playing in a different way, but absolutely wonderful. And what was amazing is that when I was starting to feel tired on my lips, and they said, Fabrizio, play, you have to play this phrase because I cannot continue. But I'm also tired. No. You play because you're stronger than me. And he was like, you know, until the end, playing everything. And now we are, you know, this pandemic that blocked all the concerts, all the activities, especially for the freelance like him. He passed like 1 year without making concert.
Yeah.
With the audience, just some streaming with the quartet or trio. So we had, because he lives in Rome also, we had the opportunity to stay together and practice together in my room, in the auditorium, when I have all my tools. And then it's amazing, because every day we start playing with a ballad, a standard, and we put the track.
Yes.
You know, the bass, the minus one, like Ebersold.
Yes.
And he is teaching to me to improvise, to make jazz improvisation, and but not just, you know, to improvise. Sometimes when I play a theme of a ballad, mm-hmm. for example, he says to me, Andrea, but you know, when you play this phrase, you play too loud, because you know, you have already told everything. You have
yes.
to keep something for all the rest of the piece. There's a lot of musical ideas. And believe me, Mark, I think, yes, we talk a lot of time about Wynton Marsalis, mm-hmm. that I was lucky to meet by person. And me and Fabrizio also, we have absolutely fun of Wynton. And I think, I don't know, because for me, I never played close to Wynton.
Yeah.
But playing close to Fabrizio when he make his improvisation of jazz music, believe me, Mark, is, I feel like to don't be a trumpet player. It's unbelievable. Unbelievable what he can play, making amazing music, every time different, with its technique stuff, unbelievable. Play like all the octaves of the trumpet, and also if you start on the double IF, mm-hmm. it's because he wants to play this tone. It's never to try, never to go up and like this.
Yes.
No. Every and he goes immediately to the lowest tone of the trumpet. With articulation, it's unbelievable, yeah. Really unbelievable. And you know, he is also amazing person. He every day he goes in the evening, you know, to the Red Cross. Like it's a lot of association in Rome that helps people cannot have foods or clothes, and he goes every evening to give his help to these people every day.
Wow.
Every day. It's unbelievable. No. And now we make some master classes together, And we have a couple of beautiful projects.
Yeah.
Like project line dreams. One is to get back to our project with the orchestra and grow up this project, getting better with new ideas, biggest orchestra and more music. Mm-hmm. And the second is to make our own academy in Rome. Yes. Where you can come and learn all the music on the trumpet. Wow, technical stuff, cool. Classic music, concert stuff, and jazz music with, absolutely, I can tell, for jazz music, for the trumpet, Fabrizio is absolutely the best for me.
Wow. Wow.
And then me for other things.
That sounds like an amazing project. And so for people who haven't seen it, it's on your Facebook page, but you have a YouTube channel also with a lot of...
Yeah, this. Yes. Also website, but it's andrealucchi.com. And anytime I have some new things, I put on my media channels. And also other projects interesting are, I have, as I teach in different academies of mm-hmm. trumpet, I have some students that follow me since a long time mm-hmm. and they doesn't want to leave me. So we made a trumpet ensemble and we play amazing music with Queen. Arrangement. Yes, great. Queen, Joe Williams, Suite, and Piazzolla. We played also Dizzy Gillespie, Manteca, and we play also classic music.
Yep.
But Bart Bacharach, we play Stardust, we play a lot of music that of easy listening music, just on 12 trumpet players. Amazing. Yes. That's interesting.
And I just wanted to mention two other things. So the orchestra just released Ein Held im Leben on a recording.
Yes, it's the last releasing, the last 3D recording. Yes.
And I've listened to it. Sounds fantastic. The orchestra sounds great. Yeah. Yeah,
it's not bad. I think life on the audience was best, because I'm never completely happy about the recordings. But as you know, this is a real live recording.
Yeah,
because when we played it, we didn't know that SED should be realized in the future. So it was like, as you know, we had a CD recording of Mahler 6 mm-hmm. also of yes. the 2011. Mm-hmm. And also that concert was, you know, we make three concerts each week. And two of these are recorded mm-hmm. by the studio of the orchestra. For the archive. And you know, when Papano conduct the concerts, he go to listen to everything, listen the rehearsals, recording all the concerts, and anytime he find something of special, he make a CD recording. So Mahler 6 was born like this, when we met in Salzburg 1 year later in 2012. I met Papano behind the stage mm-hmm. of the festival, and he ran to me and said, "Andrea, you cannot imagine. I just finished to listen to the first editing of Mahler 6. Amazing." And I was surprised. "Maestro, which editing?" "Ah, you know, do you remember the last concert in Rome of Mahler 6? "Yes, I was there." "Yes." We are make editing to release a new CD recording live. That's the way to make our live recording. It's real live recording with no correction. And so this Held im Leben is like this. It was 2 years ago, in the last two, that we had also a European tour in Germany, mm-hmm. Where we played Held im Leben and a violin concert, Beethoven violin with Anne-Sophie Mutter. Was a really beautiful tour. And after that, now we get a CD recording. It's amazing. Yes.
And then you have you mentioned earlier in this that you have your own solo CD coming out. You're going to record it.
Oh, and solo CDs, I have, the most important for me is also a live recording of my Tomasi concert. Concerto by Tomasi, because I played it in Radio Television Orchestra in Turin when I was principal trumpet there, and was a concert. It was in the 1998, about 1999 probably, and we played two concerts live on TV. No, live was. In on TV was like 1 month later, but was recording on TV, recorded, and it came also a CD recording of this live concert. For me, is one of the best things I've done in my life with the trumpet, because as you know, it's a really, really difficult trumpet concerto, because you know, I got a really great satisfaction when I received an email from Claude Tomasi. Claude.
Wow.
He wrote to me and he said, I am Mr. Lucchi, I'm son of Henri Tomasi, and I'm making a website in memory of my father, putting all the operas by my father, composition of my father. And as I found your live performance of trumpet concerto, I asked you the permission to put a sample of Tomasi concerto live on TV in the website. So if you go to the Henri Tomasi website, the trumpet concerto is played by me on TV on the 1999. This is also great satisfaction. But my own CD recording is just this, because I made all other things craziest. Nobody knows it, but I can tell you if you are interested. You know,
of course.
One day I was going to make a concert to like fundraising for a good objective, and
yes.
And they invite two groups. I had my brass quintet of the Santa Cecilia Symphony Orchestra, and we met like a pop percussion player with his group. Mm-hmm. But he was playing completely commercial music. You know, he's a percussion player. He was really famous in Italy in the 80s. Because he wrote a song that sold a lot of discs, so a lot. And so he was really famous, and we met for this beautiful concert together. And he asked to me, but what do you play? We play Bach, Monteverdi, and we can play also some Dixieland music. But no, Dixieland, I'm not interested. But Let me hear what you play of Bach. Allora, so we start playing the fugue, G fugue. Ba, ba, bi, da, da, di, da, da. And once I start playing, he took the congas. So he start playing like just with congas and his colleagues with other drum set and all my brass quintet. So it was, you cannot imagine, unplugged, unbelievable Bach.
Yeah.
It was, we called African Bach.
Yeah.
And I said that I don't have a physical CD here, because I gave all this CD to my friend. But I don't know if I can show it a big imaging of this.
Oh yeah, 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 yeah. I see this.
Okay.
Yeah.
The label is Sony Classic. It's important.
Yes.
And his name is Tony Esposito, and the project of the CD was Tam Tam Brass. Tam Tam Brass. So, you know, congas and yeah. and brasses. You know, the CD is complicated because it was not unplugged like the live concert.
Right.
And I prefer the unplugged style, just with percussion and brass. The CD is more, you know, with more sound, more instruments, because for this century, if you want to sell a CD, you have to make noise, you know?
Yes.
So we made this project where we play Mozart, Rondo alla Turca, and Samuel Scheidt, Battle Suite, or Bach, Fuga, and Bach Cantata, Air on the G String, and everything with different rhythms. But the best for me is Monteverdi Toccata, you know? Parabarabam, param, param. It's 6th century music.
Mm-hmm.
Played in a way that you cannot imagine. I have to send to you a file to listen to this because you will jump on your chair. You will jump. Absolutely. It's amazing. And and now I'm working hardly, as I told you before, to this new project for recording this CD for trumpet and piano sonatas, mm-hmm. with a really talented piano player. Is a young girl, 24 years old, Sofia Adinolfi. We met because he was playing accompaniment in my courses,
mm-hmm.
and I found that her is absolutely wonderful musician and terrific piano player. So I decided to invite her to work with me, because it's a long working for me, because as you know, we play in the orchestra all the life, and going, it's another job. So we already start preparing and rehearsing together, studying together, and also recording the rehearsals, to listening to every day. And for next January, we will go in the studio, and we will realize this big project for me. I think is the most beautiful for me.
Which what pieces will be on that recording?
Oh, for this moment, the choice is In the Mid Sonata,
mm-hmm.
and then Sonatina Jean Francais,
mm-hmm.
Legende Enescu, Onegger Intrada. This is for the trumpet players.
Yes.
Tomasi Triptych. And then, if we have space, also Rondo for Life by Leonard Bernstein. That is, you know, it's not an important piece like all the other, but I think it's funny to listen to this music, and is another way to listen to the trumpet. And also, I would like to put this seminestico composition that I loved for all my life, and I play in all the versions with the orchestra. I made arrangement for orchestra, for strings, for brass group. It's Portrait of a Trumpet. I don't know how long will be this CD. Probably is too long, but if possible, I will put all this opera inside.
Wow.
Just to show all the faces of the trumpet.
Amazing.
Yes, I'm really, you know, the pandemic blocked us to at home, and when I'm at home, I practice. I play not on the balcony. I don't love to play on the balcony. I prefer to play on the stage, but at home, and I have to work with my ideas. I cannot stop. I cannot stop, because I think I get, as we talk before about the problems on the lips, the dystony, I had like a second chance in my life to play the trumpet, and I want to use it until the end.
Yes, absolutely. Yes. Hey, so Andrea, hold on just a second, but I'll sign off of Facebook
Live,
And thanks everybody that watched. I really appreciate it. And Andrea, thank you so much for doing this.
Thank you to you. It was really great pleasure for me to talk to you, and hope to see you again on Zoom, or why not?
In person.
By person. Yes, in person. Yes, playing.